Thank you very much. Thank you, SPARC Japan, for inviting me to your beautiful country and to this venue. And I'm Ron Dekker. I'm currently at the European Commission. And as I'm seconded to the Commission, I must make a remark beforehand. I don't speak on behalf of the Commission, but I know what's going on in the Commission. So that just as a reminder. I will briefly discuss what is open science, just to get aligned, and then go into open science policy, focus on publications and data, and try to explore a vision on open science. So open science, it's a change in the way we will do science, the way science is performed. And this will refer to the total research cycle. So from conception of ideas, analysis, data collection, publication, review, all these are affected by this trend of open science. And why is this trend? It's first of all because of the digitization. Data are available in an exponential way, and there is a need for transparency. For example, in psychology, about half of the publications is the results are not reproducible. So we must find new ways to be accountable for the research. And we need, science needs to connect better with society at large, and that includes enterprises, but also society. And especially as we need to tackle grand challenges, societal questions on poverty, on diseases, so the societal problems. And sometimes you could see open science as an umbrella term. So it comprises data, publications, software, even integrity, the way you keep track of your research, sometimes called open notebook, and citizen science. So citizens actively participate in doing science. And it's difficult to have one definition. I like the one by Michael Nielsen, where he says it's the idea that scientific knowledge is openly shared as early as possible. And yes, there can be reasons why not sharing immediately, or to have some barriers still imposed, but this is the core, sharing openly and sharing as quick as possible. And just to show that it's already happening, let's see what's available. There are a lot of tools already available. And sometimes this is compared to the traditional science is the inner circle, where you have conception of ideas, you have data collection, analysis, publication, review, the traditional cycle. But the outer cycle points that there is much more interaction. That there is much more interaction with the outside world. And so open science is about connecting science. And at the European Commission, this trend of open science was used in 2014 to start a consultation among all stakeholders, researchers, publishers, funders, societies. And the main topics were publication and data and research infrastructure. These were the main drivers for open science. And there were also barriers. One of them is the quality assurance. If we go in the open as soon as possible, how do we assure quality? How do we give credits that will become important when we want to share data? Is there sufficient infrastructure to share the data and to share our knowledge? And are researchers and non-researchers even aware of the benefits that are enclosed in current science. And so we set a number of priorities. As I said before, it's on data and publications. And this was taken over not only by the Euro Commissioner, Carlos Moedas, but also by Sander Dekker, who is the State Secretary of Science in the Netherlands. And it, the Netherlands was the president of the European Council last year. And we decided to have these open science items a priority in science. So I will now go very briefly into the results of this Dutch presidency, but I think the slides are available. I will go very quickly through them to come back to the priorities of and the policy of the European Commission. But just to show what the work was when doing this presidency, we decided to have some deliverables on data, on policy. And this first one, this task force on optimal reuse of research data, just came up with a number of activities and recommendations on training of data, data management, sustainability, and the IP issues of data. And this is just to show that it's very complicated on keeping track of optimal reuse of data. We deliberately didn't call this open data because I think that open data may suggest that the data should be always in the open immediately. I can think of situations of sensitive data, of first use rights of data, that data are not openly on the internet immediately, but that you have to apply for these data or make yourself known that you are going to reuse this data. So this was an expert report on data. During the presidency, we had a presidency conference in Amsterdam where we worked on a very operational way to two goals. One is to have full open access by 2020 to publications. And the second was to prepare a new approach for sharing data. And we realized in doing this work that you need a flanking policy. And I think the most important one is to have a reward system that acknowledge that you share data, you get credits for that. In the current system, at least in Europe, you are not rewarded for sharing data at the moment. You are rewarded for publishing in high prestige journals. Not for education, not for sharing data, not for sharing your knowledge. And we think we have to change this reward system, because otherwise there won't be an incentive to share. And the fourth one is a little bit cryptic, but it says, share your knowledge, have monitoring systems. To say it bluntly, some nations or universities don't have an idea on the costs of publications. They know the contract costs of the subscriptions. But what about the cost on the article processing charges for gold open access? So we have to collect these data and share this information about the costs of publications. So there were 12 recommendations, and just to show this is very practical, stating the problem, give a direction to the solution, and on the next page, each stakeholder is addressed with what he or she should do. Back to the European Commission. In May last year, there were the Council conclusions that were accepted by all member states. So the research ministers of 28 member states of the European Council adopted these conclusions. And that was a very strong political statement saying, we want open science. It was a political statement by all these member states. And they want to stress the importance of open science. And there are some measures to do this. And I will briefly go into the different topics. First of all, it's the importance of open science. The second bullet is on establishing a platform. And this is an open science policy platform, which consists of all the stakeholders, or at least a delegation of all these stakeholders. This platform consists of 25 members from publishers, funders, universities, applied research, young researchers, and the commission set up this platform to get advice on how to proceed on this open science. And the third bullet is, what is the direction that open science should go to? It's to make results open as soon as possible, to have TDM, text and data mining, and also retain your copyright. That could be one solution of getting out of the current situation, where there is no access or paid access. And on the second slide, especially item 12, was important, open access in 2020. Because in a political statement, it's very important to get a date in. And we managed to get this 2020 in the council conclusions. So all the member states agree that we want open access to publications in 2020. On the data side, it's more generic, saying we want optimal reuse, data should be a public good. But as we will see later, that's perhaps not the opinion of all the researchers who do all the work on the data. So, yes, in Europe we now have a strong policy statement. We have agreement among all the member states. We have national policies on open access, on open science. But how do we put this policy into action? And in the Commission came up with an agenda. It introduced expert groups, this policy platform, which I already explained, and implemented open science in its programs. So this open agenda, like this Amsterdam call, it is dealing with the barriers, how to give incentives, to provide infrastructure, and in fact to make open science normal science. It should be a normal way to produce and to share knowledge as soon as possible. And in this agenda, it was decided to focus on 8 key issues. The reward system, as it is an important flanking policy. Measuring quality, as the current journal impact factor is a proxy for measuring quality of journals, not of research or articles. It's on journal level. We want to discuss the future of publishing models. We introduced the FAIR principle, findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable data. There is the science cloud, which is meant to be an infrastructure for the data and all research output. Research integrity, making results reproducible, is important. The participation of citizens and training people. It's also on the skills. And the Commission installed or will install expert groups on all these items and also install this policy platform. As I said before, this policy platform consists of 25 stakeholders. It advises the Commission, and it is expected to have an overarching view on these eight items. So how can the European Commission proceed on fostering and catalyzing the transition to open science? And this is just a very complicated picture to explain this. I won't discuss it now, but you see extensively, you will see on the left-hand side, there is all kinds of input, and the platform can have its own working groups, and in the end, it will advise the Commission, but also take the result back to its own organizations. So if they agree in the Open Science Policy Platform on a measure, they can easily implement it at all the stakeholders. The Commission also implemented open science in its research programs, of which the eight framework program, also known as Horizon 2020, is the most important one. And there is an obligation to provide open access on publications, either green or gold, and you have to deposit as soon as possible and make it available between 6 and 12 months, depending on the discipline. And the gold open access costs, the article processing charges, for example, are eligible, so you can pay them from your grant. And the same goes for data. They are required, if you are a grantee, you are required to deposit the data in a repository and to give access to these data. And again, we want to have this fair data statement and also to share the data beyond publication. So it's not only the data that are used for this publication, but more the general research data to be shared. And there was a pilot with data management plans because we think these DMPs create awareness among the researchers that they create something that is valuable for other people. And in the pilot, you had the option to opt out, so it was voluntarily, and about 2/3 of the people just remained in from the pilot programs. And outside the pilot programs, an additional 10% opted in voluntarily. And we evaluated it, and it was concluded that this pilot will be extended to cover all the programs in Horizon 2020. And it's a rather easy and simple procedure. Say which data you will generate, how you will make the data available, and you are asked to provide information on the curation, on the setup of the data. And as I said before, it's creating awareness among the researchers, and it's about getting these data out of the laptop of the researchers and to have it at an institutional repository database or at a national one or a disciplinary one. So this data management plan is quite important it's a necessary condition for sharing data. These are the policy actions to make sharing data, sharing publications concrete at the Commission. So we have this political statement, we have the policy, we have the expert groups, stakeholder platform, and we have implemented in the grant regulations. And at the international scene, we also see a lot of support for these data and for open science. And just to go quickly through this national policies, you can see most countries have a policy on open access. It has the attention of the G7, which made the statement last year. And it's also at the attention of the G20. And it will be on the agenda of the upcoming G7 meeting that will be in Europe. And there is a specific point on the agenda, open science, which will focus on the reward system and the cloud infrastructure. And this agenda item is prepared jointly by Japan and the European Commission. So that far for policy. Let's now go into publications and data. On publications, just to give an idea of who is dealing with open access policy, I use the slide of SPARC 2010 to point at countries who are active in open access policy. And that's quite a lot. And so it is on the agenda for a lot of countries. But on publishing, what are we talking about? Just to give you an impression and about the potential outside science, I've looked at the population developments in 2050. And then you will see that there is a huge shift to Asian countries. It's there where the people will live, and that's the potential for science, that's the potential for innovation, it's the potential for the economy. So this makes clear that if we can better connect science to society, that there is a huge potential waiting outside science. And going back to publishing, just to give an idea of the number of publications. Each year there are about 3 million publications. 90% of them are citable. And they get, about half of them gets a citation. But if we subtract the self citations, we end up with about 1 million citations for 2.7 million papers. So only one out of three papers get cited. So that's an impact factor of 0.3. Whereas everybody is hunting on these impact factors of 30 or 40. But if you have 30, then a lot of people won't have no citations at all. So that should make people think, for whom are we publishing all these papers? Who are we sharing this knowledge? And do we get reached? Do we end up with the readers? And for your information, this is by country. And of course, I've looked into the data as long as possible just to find out that the Netherlands is comparable to Japan. That's only finding the data. Finding a journal is a different topic because there are 35,000 journals. So for 3 million papers, that should be enough. But how to be found in these 35,000? And moreover, if you are going for high impact journals, realize that it's only 1% of these 35,000 that have an impact factor of 5 and more, and just another percentage having an impact of 3 or more. I know in the Netherlands, researchers are encouraged to publish in journals which have an impact factor of 2 or more. But this is only 4% of all the research journals. And also to point at the relevance, if you want to have a high impact journal that you should write a review, because that gets cited most. But in astronomy and physics, in 2015, there were in this journal only 16 papers. So you have to be one of these 16. Then you get cited. But is this science? Is this what we are spending our public money on to get into one of these journals? Because I think it has become a goal in itself to be in these journals. And that you can see what is in the current system. I think publishers manage very well to make full use of the internet, subdividing markets with the help of IP addresses. And there are big deals that make it very attractive to take a subscription on all the journals. But it also makes it difficult to quit one of the journals, because then you have to quit the whole deal. And this journal impact factor also helps to have an economic lock-in. So once in, it's very difficult to step out. And that is because the other stakeholders themselves, they use this journal impact factor as a proxy for quality. It happens in the research councils, where you decide on the grants. It happens at the universities. It happens at the university rankings. And there is a first mover disadvantage. If you decide to step out of the system, you won't be in these rankings anymore. And that might have political consequences or consequences on the money you will receive. So there is an incentive to publish in high prestige journals instead of doing risky research. And because if you want to get into such a journal, you better have significant, nice results. And if you have non-significant or negative results, that won't make it to a top journal. And this will lead to a publication bias. And there are examples in clinical trials where you have a bias on only the positive clinical trials. Whereas if you go and search on the internet, you find as many studies on negative or non-significant outcomes of these trials. So we get only part of the information. So we need to change this reward system. But on the other hand, it pays off. It pays off for the researcher and the publishers. Because researchers give to publishers their copyright, which gives an ability to run a business. And they give excellent articles, which increase the value of this journal. And publishers give to researchers reputation. And this reputation helps in getting a grant or getting prestige within your university. So it's a win-win situation. But someone has to pay the bill. And this is who pays the bill. It's the libraries or the universities who have to pay the increasing costs of the journals because of the price increases, because of more and more journals are available. So that was one of the reasons to look for other models. And then we go to this open access. And why do we want to go there? First of all, it's feasible. Make use of this internet technology where it's very easy and cheap to copy and to distribute. It might be very efficient. And also because funders want more return. It's not only publishing. It's also on sharing your knowledge, sharing the outcomes. So impact becomes broader, or should become broader. And not only be scientific impact, but also impact on society or innovation. And there is an important principle. Results of publicly financed research should be publicly available. Or put otherwise, research that is worth funding should be worth sharing. And that's an important principle for open access. And we need it. If we want to connect science with society, we have to get better connection, better access to the publications and the output. It may benefit science, because it's very focused now on outcomes within your discipline. I think it's Elsevier Digest, it's a journal meant to explain what's happening in a discipline. And this is not used by the general public. It's used by researchers in other disciplines to learn about these disciplines. So it's helping science itself, the interaction, and we can work on improving integrity and trust in science. And I think you know all this already. It's the different variants, gold, green, hybrid. But there is a lot of misunderstanding on open science, and we have to explain this over and over again. It's not an obligation to publish. It's not at odds with patenting. If you want to have a patent, don't publish yet, either in an open access system or in a subscription model. You first have to have the patent, and then you publish. And there is no difference in the peer review process. Both have peer review. And yes, there are predatory journals in open access, but there are also lousy journals in this in the other system. And there are even journals that copy existing articles in a new journal and set it on a subscription model. So we want, if we want open access, we need to have these policies. And as I said, most countries already have these policies, most on green, some on gold. I think the most simple and perhaps elegant policy is the one by the Gates Foundation. It's a one-pager, it's five items, and it says just publish immediately in open access. We will take care of the cost and we'll pay a fair price, and we want you to share the data. And that's in fact the very simple policy of the Gates Foundation, and it says no exceptions. And it's now in use after a 2-year probation or incubation period. So I think in open access to publications, we rather know what directions to go. If we look at the optimal reuse of research data, it becomes a little bit more complicated. Whereas publishing is, at least for Europe, it's in a transition of going from one publishing model to new publishing models. On research data, it's on a combination of items. And in the European Commission, there are three pillars. It's on this cloud, taking care of the infrastructure and making connection with the content. And that is what is meant with the ESRIs. ESRIs are large research infrastructures producing a lot of data. So here is part of this content. There is the data infrastructure, providing high-performance computing, networking, software, and the idea is to end the silos, to have HPC, to have networking, to have software, and to combine these services or these activities into a service. So it is infrastructure as a service. As a researcher, I have some questions. I need storage, I need computation, I need to connect with my colleagues, and this should be provided as a service. And we want to widen access and also include the small and intermediate companies, industry, and government. To focus on this European Open Science Cloud, the former chair of this committee once said, well, it's not European, it's international. It's not open because it may be closed for some data. It's not science because it's science and it's innovation and it's public. And it's not a cloud, it's real. It's a data service on the ground that provide these facilities. And in fact, it's creating an environment for researchers to store and manage and reuse the data. And we are aware that there is already a lot of infrastructure at universities, at institutes, on a national level with supercomputers, and even at the European level. And the challenge will be how to connect this and to have a federation of existing and new infrastructures. So that's dealing with the governance issues and how to combine all these facilities. This is described in the report that came out in October last year on this European Science Cloud. And just to address one of the items, it is about these three items. It's setting up a governance, provide the content on data, provide new services, and to have the infrastructure up and running. This is, in fact, the challenge on this cloud. And I've already introduced this FAIR concept, which is data should be findable and accessible, etc. And one of the attempts of the Dutch Dance Institute is to give a kind of a Michelin guide for data, saying, what if we consider these first three items as separate items, dimensions, have four or five questions on each of them, and then come up with a score. And then you get a general score by just dividing this by three. And this is a first way of making this data known, because I think one of the challenges is to have these data findable. There is a lot of data out there, but how do I find the data? And just to stress that these clouds are already existing, I've seen examples of the National Institutes of Health, the NIH Commons, the National Science Foundation as a cloud. There are commercial clouds by Microsoft and Amazon. And what strikes me is that these are mostly US examples, because I think they start just with pilots, and the NIH is running a $6 million pilot on this cloud. And I think in Europe, we are more top down. We think about the governance and want to have everything in place, and then we start. But this approach gives you a head start, because you have the backbones and the facilities in your country. If the US will invest in cloud, US research will invest in cloud, it will be national investment. If Europe wants to invest in cloud, and we go to these providers, it will be an international investment. And I think we should also tune up and prepare national providers or European providers to deliver these services. And I think for this, we need these pilots. And as I said, data should be findable. And but in order to reuse the data, they should be trusted. And this data seal of approval, which is by the Dance Institute, but also by WDS, which is, I think, in Japan. It says, we provide a tool that gives you confidence that the data can be found, are in a good format, are reliable. And because if I want to reuse the data have to be trusted. And they also provide identifiers of for data sets. And that's important if you want to give credits to a researcher who made the data, that you can point to the data. But as I already explained, I think on data, on sharing data, optimal reuse of data, it's a cultural change to bring trust, to stimulate the sharing of data. And for this, we need to be able to refer to the data, so they should have identifiers. But we must also reward or give incentives to the data producers to share their data. And we need authentication of the data producers, of the users. So ideally, there is a kind of single sign-on to these to get access to the data. Make yourself known if you provide data, and make yourself known if you are using the data. And especially in life sciences and social sciences, we have to take care of how to deal with sensitive data. Some data cannot be open on the internet, but are still relevant for research. So how do we tackle that? So to conclude, on the data infrastructure, the direction is less clear. We know some directions. We know we want to have incentives for sharing. We need reward structure. We need identifiers. But how to do this exactly isn't that elaborated yet. So let me now go to the final part, a vision on open science. And I will start again on the publications and then go to the data. If you look at the trends, and the Association of Publishers came up with their trends, but please just look at the main items. And it says the article is a hub and spoke, and it's about data as a research object. So data becomes a research outcome and should be shared. And to make it even more challenging for you, is the 2020 outlook, and I've summarized it. It's about big data and combination of data and artificial intelligence. In the middle is the machine might be a new reader. Go through the articles, go through the data, and maybe an assisting tool for the researchers. And I think personally, this one is very important to deliver precision information. If we have 3 million papers a year, and as a researcher, I can read 300, 400, I need some help in selecting. And in early days, you could go to a journal and say, I just read one or two journals. But the number of journals has increased, and it might happen that a relevant article is in another journal. So I need help on this selecting, on this filtering. And I think here is the value added for in the publishing to assist in this filtering. Because if I look at my son, who is 15, he won't pay for content. He will go on the internet to find it, to find music, to find movies, etc. But he might get help, want help to find it. And for that, he has his social network, etc. But in research, we need to get help in finding the relevant information. And I think in publishing, it is clear that you, as an author, you want as much readers to reach. And readers want to have the relevant articles. So there is a market, there is supply of publications, and there is a need for these publications. And I think the new direction would be to have a platform strategy. This figure is based on an article in the Harvard Business Review saying if we want to have a strategy, we have to think differently. And we have a shift in focus. It's not about marginal costs, etc. It's on interactions, exchange of value between a producer and a user on that platform. And they give examples of these platforms where you have the owner, the provider, the producers, and the users. And one of the big examples is Apple. They own a platform that is run by the iPhone and the iPad. And it's not about calling. It's about applications. It's the App Store. It's the iTunes. And here are the users. And the success of Apple is in making this connection. Another example is the Sony PlayStation. Sony has the PlayStation 4. There are games, there are players. But in addition, Sony has an extra connection to its system, saying if you want to play worldwide, you have to get a subscription, a monthly subscription, and then you can play against anyone in the world. So it's adding value on this platform that counts. And I think that will be the direction for publishing also, to have good connections, to have good interactions between users and producers. And I think you've seen this one before in an earlier presentation. There is this 101 innovations, making note of all the tools that are available. And they should be called now 400 plus innovations, because that's the number of innovations that are available on doing open science. And they have this spreadsheet where you can find all these applications. And to end up with the publishing process, just as an example. This is the traditional one. You write an article, submit, get rejected, submit again to another journal, get peer reviewed, it's rejected or it's you should improve. The article is accepted, you publish, and it's in the journal. But the people outside science don't see this, or you have to pay, if you don't have a subscription, $30 to get access to one of these articles. So there is a paywall, and we have come with the green open access, saying we have an embargoed one, or we have a preprint, and that is available. But that is not the same version as it is here. So we came up with gold, saying in the end of the process, we change it. We take care of payment and make it available for everyone. But it is a question whether this gold model becomes the standard or will exist next to the other models. Therefore, I think in publishing, there is a new idea by the Wellcome Trust. It's called Open Research. And they say, if you have an article, just publish it, send it to us. Within 1 week, it is published. And after that, it is peer reviewed. So you first publish and then peer review. And this peer review is open. And the outcome is available. And this not only goes for publications, but also for your lab results or data. I don't have a clue yet how they going to review data, but I think they will find a way of giving a statement of the quality of a data set. So here you have a shift of saying, I first publish and then do the quality assessment. And you could go even one step further and say, what if we put research back in the middle again? So I have research, I have my research box here. I decide whether I make it public or not. If I make it public, I can have different alternatives. I send it to a traditional journal, to a gold open access, or to this open research. I don't go for peer review even don't go for peer review and just have the preprint posted. And then I can get access. And that makes it very easy, I think, for researchers. It also makes it very easy for funders, because I only want to stress this figure. It's very easy to become open access compliant with your funder. To have compliance. And in addition, this model has a fair price of getting peer reviewed. It is about $750. And this could be a new way, but it's still within the existing system of having journals. Another trend is preprints. If funders are willing to acknowledge preprints, which do get identifier and say it's eligible in grants to refer to a preprint, I think that will help young researchers. Because if you are on a two-year postdoc grant, you don't have time to submit a paper which takes 1 year to get published. If you get a timestamp on this preprint and you can use it in your new application for the grant, that will help. And it will speed up the publishing and the sharing of knowledge. And we could have a system of trusted repositories to where these preprints can go to. So these are some trends in sharing knowledge in terms of publications. And I think this is the direction it could go to. On data, I need your help. I can see the impact of data. And there is even calculations of the enormous value that data have if you take into account the amount of labor or the amount of labor that is needed to restructure these data. But I think one of the problems is if I, as a researcher, put a lot of effort in preparing data and I share them, someone else will get the revenues by saving a lot of time for producing a paper or producing new knowledge. So how do we set up for a market on sharing data? I think that is one of the main questions. And yes, of course, we have infrastructures. And there can be, as I said, there can be pilots. And we can have a discussion whether we should have a national policy for all disciplines, or by discipline work internationally, or perhaps do both and see how they come together. And I know of one example where there is a win-win situation, because I think that is very critical to create a market. This example of the Structural Genomics Consortium managed to get the pharmaceuticals in a joint effort and saying at some moment in time we will split, and then everyone goes for the competition and the money. And what I did here is they set up a trusted third party, because they had 10 or 20 pharmaceuticals research groups, and they asked to each of them, give us your top three of proteins that you want to investigate. They collected it and they made a top 30 without revealing the individual preferences, so without revealing what the companies were working on or interested in. And the researchers agreed to work on this top 30 proteins. And there you have a win-win. You have a lot of data and you have a lot of research capacity. And I think on data, we have to find this demand and supply, these producers of data and the users of data. And I think that will be the challenge of the data, for the data. As I said, I can see the value of data. I can see the enormous supply of data, but we have to make them findable. And perhaps, but that's just a basic idea, perhaps it could be the libraries who could play an intermediate role, saying, we know what's going on. In our university, we are connected to other libraries, so we have some idea what's going on elsewhere. And if you have a question on data, it could be with the help of the librarian that you could find these data. So we need this intermediate. And just to conclude, I think we should be part of this new era of open science, because that will be the trend. We want to reach more people, have greater impact, not only in science, but also societal. We could prevent duplication of efforts or prevent publication bias. We need to preserve data for future use, so have impact in science, in society, in innovation. And just as a personal note, that I think the challenge is how to cooperate, how to innovate, and especially how to share. And I'm happy to be here in Japan, because if my first acquaintance with Japan was twofold. One was with a film, a very traditional film, The Ballad of Narayama. And the other one is the book, The Knowledge Creating Firm, where innovation was explained and revealed how you do this in traditional companies. And I think it's this combination of tradition and understanding the past and having the guts to innovate and to change that will lead us to new ideas in open science, in reusing data, in making open access to publications. And there is a South African verb that says, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So we are going to take questions. We have some time to take questions. Anyone, any questions? Please state, raise your hand and state your name and affiliation. And Mr. Dekker is going to wear a receiver, so you can ask questions in Japanese as well. Yes, I see a hand over there. Thank you very much. I'm going to ask a question in Japanese because I understand there is a translator or interpreter. Fukagai from Yokohama National University. I'm a member of the steering committee of SPARC Japan. Kajiwara-san and organizers, thank you very much for this opportunity. Now, about open science, which is attracting a lot of attention in Japan. We have active discussions as well. In a way, we're talking about a paradigm shift in thinking about human knowledge. So looking over the history, the information or the scientific reform through the Gutenberg's printing industry, all of the information became open and scientists' behaviors changed. And I think similar thing is happening today, especially based on internet or network. Information that is not printed is now available, and human behaviors are changing accordingly. That's what's happening today. Electronic journals mean just the electronic versions of the paper versions, so that's part of tradition, whereas more recently, recent trend is that people are using network and exchanging the knowledge through network. And through that exchange, many people can now be part of the creation of knowledge and sharing of ideas. And open science is an attempt to further accelerate this. Now, one barrier is this. When you have internet and electronic journals, now through the impact factor, the outcome of research science is now becoming owned by some people, which means that for scientists and researchers, your knowledge, when you put lots of efforts to get attention, you tend to really get narrow in your focal areas so as to get the attention. Whereas in order to activate and enrich the human activities, I think you should take a more broader view. So there's a dilemma here. Now, issue is this. In relation to the fund providers, the outcome of the research activities where you have the public grants, you need to make it open. I wonder if you see a dilemma there. Any thoughts on this?
Thank you very much for this question. And I couldn't agree more on your explanation of the history and the trend that is going on. And it also points that we are in a paradigm shift because we must make a step from making the print version available, even with the two columns reading on the internet, and to go fully digitally born outputs. And that's why I like this Wellcome Trust open research, because it not only focuses on the traditional storytelling article, but also on intermediate results. If you have important data that you want to share, you can publish. There is a journal, Science Matters, where you can publish intermediate lab results if you think they are important for your research community. So I think we have to find new outputs beyond the traditional publication. And then I think in measuring these outputs, we will need new indicators beyond this impact factor on journals. But if we broaden up the outputs, I think the metrics will follow. And the funders should reward these alternative or new outputs. If you have important contribution to innovation or to a societal discussion, that should be rewarded by the funders and the universities. And there are examples, pilots of universities and medical faculties that say, we have a different reward system for our researchers. And it's there where it should start. And at the funders, they should say to their committee members, stop counting the publications. And an alternative could be to ask for the top three or top five publications and then ask the reviewer to go through the publication instead of counting and adding up impact factors, which is no sense. And you cannot compare impact factor over disciplines. So you are comparing different things. So, and there is one initiative in the DORA initiative saying we will use qualitative information to assess research. And I think that is a way to go. And we should acknowledge preprints and other types of output as valuable research output.
Did that answer your question? There is one hand. We have run out of time. So if you have any more questions, please write down your questions on your question seat. And thank you very much, Mr. Ron Dekker. Please give him a big round of applause once again.